You're listening to the Teach Better Talk podcast, featuring expert educators eager to share progressive tactics to reach more students. Teach Better Talk is created by teachers and fueled by passion. Let's get started.
Hey everyone, welcome to episode 265. My name is, 265 of Teach Better Talk podcast. Jeff, you have to say the name of the podcast in the intro. Come on.
I mean, technically, like, there's a little music thing that plays before, so they should already know what it is, but you know, let's say a best practice.
I would recommend. You know, guys, it's only been 265 episodes, so we haven't gotten it perfect yet. What can we say? My name is Ray Hewitt. I'm here with Jeff Gargas, and there is so much in store for you, but I am really excited to kind of dive into one thing first, if we could do that, Jeff.
Sure. Well, I guess, let me say, depends on what it is. But probably.
You doubt my direction of the podcast introduction?
Anyone who has listened to more than three episodes would.
Wait, can I say, do you know what was so nice? Somebody called me, they were on the phone with me yesterday, and they were like, Ray, sometimes I turn on the Teach Better Talk podcast and I really enjoy it. And I was like, that is so kind of you to say.
Sometimes.
And wait, and then they're like, but I have to skip the first 10 minutes because you and Jeff are ridiculous.
I was waiting for, now other times, though, I turn on the Teach Better Talk podcast, and I really don't enjoy
it. I think they meant, like, I really enjoy the guests, but, yeah, I skipped the beginning. And then I, like, originally, like, whined. I was like, don't do that. We have so much fun. And then I'm like, but I get it.
It is what it is. Yeah. We do these intros first.
Yeah, for sure. Guys, this is our therapy for the week. We do these Monday nights at, like, 8 o'clock in the evening. This is our, like, weekly breakdown, okay? It's true.
It is. Okay. What do you want to talk about?
No, Jeff, I just wanted to mention the Grid Method webinar that we just announced that's happening this June. Can we dive into that really quick?
We can totally dive into that.
All right. Well, we have people ask us all the time about the Grid Method. That's obviously the mastery framework that we do a ton of professional development on for educators across, I don't know, North America, everywhere. It seems like we're always talking about it. But I want to make sure that our listeners know that, yes, there's a free course in the Academy. There's a full workshop in the Academy. Yes, we do PDNs all the time. But what I like about this webinar is we're just going to talk shop twice a week and get you all set up to have a final grid all finished, ready for the school year by the end of this webinar series. So I think it's a great opportunity if you're somebody who's been thinking about incorporating mastery learning into your classroom, thinking about exploring how you can reach all of your learners. It could be fun. Let's hang out this June.
Yeah. And so that's going, what, June?
It's June 14th through July 7th. And here's the details. Let's break this down. Each session is an hour and a half. We're going to do this Wednesday and Monday at 9 a.m. So it's like 9 a.m. to 9:30 Eastern time.
Well, it's 9 a.m. to 10:30.
I'm sorry. 9 a.m. to 10:30. Yes. You're right. I'm looking at the notes in front of me. I just can't read. Yeah.
So two times a week for 4 weeks? So eight sessions?
Two times a week for 4 weeks, eight sessions, an hour and a half each. So we're going to, it's a blending of, it really is how we do our workshop for the districts that we partner with. But we're going to do a little bit of conversation, really diving into educational philosophy concepts. And then we're going to give you work time to actually build your grid. So the hope would be that every single session, you're building little parts and pieces. And in the end, you should have a grid that you've not only built on your own, but you got feedback on and you've tweaked and adjusted and now you're ready for students. And I think it's a great opportunity. We did offer this a bunch last summer and it was a huge success. So we just kind of, like you guys know, we listened to our audience and we decided to offer more. This will not be the only one we offer, but I do really encourage, and I know this is like a mom thing, I encourage you to do it early so you get it done, right? Like, don't wait all summer, guys. Don't wait around. Let's do this in June. Let's get you feeling confident by the end of this. We'll hang out over the summer, and then you'll get time to enjoy and relax, and you'll already have your first unit done.
The early bird gets the worm.
That's what they say. Wait, really quick, Jeff. I do want to make sure. If you guys don't know what the grid method is, go to teachbetter.com/ the grid method, and you can literally see an abundance of resources, including this webinar. But if you already know what the grid method is, maybe you've heard about it, and you just want to register, all you need to do is go to teachbear.com/grid summer webinar, and that will be where you can register for this one.
Here's the best part. You forgot the best part about this one in particular.
That it's me.
It's being led by Ray. Like, that's the best part.
You're so sweet.
So, yes. Awesome. Yeah, it was a huge hit last year.
I'm stoked.
So it was sort of on demand that we had to bring it back. So super excited for that. With the registration, you also get the replays and an online course that you'll have access to forever. So you can go back and watch them again and again, listen to the questions asked again, the resources are housed there. You get a lot for it. It's good.
Yeah. And wait, we also should mention, this is for any educator in any subject area, in any area of the world. Honestly, especially because it's recorded. Even if you live out of the U.S. or you're not in our time zone, doesn't work for you, it's still a great spot for you. You can still get feedback and training. So I just want to put that out there. So I hope you guys register.
Yeah, I think another thing to mention is, like, this still works for someone who's, if you've done the grid method before and you're just trying to hone some of your school skills, you're going to have the opportunity for collaboration and talk and stuff. But if you've never done it, this is also going to allow you to now go. I'd recommend definitely jumping into at least the free course before this, just to have the terminology down, but it's going to fit for anybody. So it's going to be good.
Well, Jeff, if you remember last year, we also had like administrators come in and they designed grids for like professional development for their staff at the beginning of the year. So anyway, it's going to be a party. Come join us and go to teachbear.com/grid summer webinar and go register.
I love it. All right. This episode. Good episode. This dude's cool. I enjoyed this. I really enjoyed the story. It got me thinking things. So Dan Fouts is a high school government, U.S. history, and philosophy teacher. He's been teaching. He's in there, he said, now actually 29 years. And he also works with his brother with something that they call Teach Different. Yes, that's teachdifferent.com. And no, we are not connected. However, we're definitely fans of theirs now. I really enjoyed the story of how that started. It's so cool, like how sort of mirrored the start of our story and stuff. Good guy. I just love this guy's passion and what he's trying to do, what him and his brother are trying to do, the impact they're trying to make, the hustle that they have right now with teaching, but still trying to build the strength, still trying to share it, still trying to impact people. So, you know, I'm a fan of that. So Ray, anything to add before we dive in?
I'm a fan of these new friends of ours, and let's get listening.
All right, let's get into episode 265 with Dan Fouts. Hey, what's up, podcast? It's Jeff. Don't worry, I'm going to get you right back in the episode. But first, I want to introduce you to our Comeback Better packages. You know, COVID-19 and the coronavirus pandemic has really changed so much about how we live our lives, how we socialize, and especially how we run our schools and classrooms. As we begin to look towards the next school year, things are going to be different. But we can be better because of it. That's where our Comeback Better packages come in. These have been strategically designed to support you and your staff as you prepare for or manage things like preparing a growth mindset, preparing to close the learning gaps created by COVID-19 and school closures, restructuring curriculum alignment, continuing creating safe environments for dialogue and reflection, supporting an in-person or virtual or hybrid learning environment, and supporting staff and students whose socioeconomic status has changed due to COVID-19. We are here for you. These packages are 100% customizable to fit your staff, your students, your community, and your needs. Find out more at teachbetter.com/comebackbetter. Let's get back to the episode. All right. We are here. We are chatting with Dan Fouts. And Dan, it's awesome to have you on the podcast. I'm super excited to dive into everything you've got going on, learn more about you, what you guys got going on at Teach Different, and hear your story. But before we get too far into all of that stuff, man, how are you feeling right now?
I'm feeling like it's May, what is it, May 3rd, and it's been the weirdest school year of my life.
Huh. I think that sums it up well, because you were like, I'm feeling like it's May, what is it, May 3rd? Like, that's pretty accurate right there.
I mean, this is my 28th year in the profession, and I have 5 years left till retirement. And, you know, this has been the strangest year to kind of begin the closeout to my career. It's just been beyond compare. I mean, what do you say?
Yeah, I know. I think a lot of educators are probably feeling you. I think this has been the craziest year ever, but it kind of makes it fun. We have a lot of jokes and stories to tell now. You know what I mean? Come on, let's see the positive.
Oh, totally. And then you can look back and go, do you remember when
Exactly. Yeah. We're going to be those people with the stories of that we walked to school in the snow barefoot uphill both ways. Like, that will be it.
Only it's kind of like the complete opposite. We didn't have to walk to school at all. Like,
true.
Because we just did virtually.
It's true. Well, Dan, I want to make sure our listeners right off the bat get to hear about everything that you're involved in, because truly, I am so excited to not only learn your story here, but dig into the work that you are currently doing. So would you mind kind of answering that age-old question of, hey, Dan, what do you do?
What do you do? This is my 28th year. I'm a high school teacher. I teach social studies in the Chicagoland area, in the district just north of O'Hare Airport, if you've been into Chicago. And I've been there since 93. I teach advanced placement government, regular government. I taught American studies. I taught U.S. history. And I've been teaching a philosophy elective for 10 years that I was able to convince my district was really, really important to do. So that's been my professional career. And then I have a twin brother who has experience in the urban setting in Chicago. And about 3 years ago, he started an organization called Teach Different, which is all about, you know, having conversations with young people and kind of helping people learn how to think critically and to have those kinds of conversations that changes your kids' lives. And he started this, and he kind of bothered me for 8 or 9 months and was using it in we have a protocol that we do in Teach Different, a conversation protocol. He was using it in one of the most difficult teaching environments you could ever imagine. You know, here's me in the suburbs. I have very few, you know, issues with classroom management, and he's in a school district where it's underserved. There's a lot of challenges that, you know, just make teaching very difficult. So he came up with this idea of how to have conversations using philosophical quotes. He also has a philosophy background as I do. And then he bothered me for 8 months, and then I caved in, and ever since I've been working with him to build out organization Teach Different. That's a nutshell of where I am.
Okay, so this is really interesting to me, because obviously, like, I think anyone listens going, oh, teachdifferent.com, teachbetter.com, like, what are you guys in on it together? And no, we're not. But what's really interesting, Dan, is what's your brother's name? Let's make sure you give him a proper shout out.
Steve.
So shout out to Steve. But similar to how you just described how Steve created this method that he has for these conversations, really, really mirrors so much of how we got started with Chad Ostrowski, who's our CEO, like him creating what we call the grid method, which is one of the big things that we do, which kind of started stuff in his classroom, high needs. He was struggling. Mm-hmm. He had to find a way to do it. So it's just interesting that both of these stories had that kind of start. Now, he didn't have to convince me. It was pretty quick. And I'm not his twin, thankfully. But but an interesting story. So can you give us a little bit more on this three? It's a three-step method, right? For, I think the site says, for unforgettable conversations that give students the courage to speak, listen, understand. Can you give us sort of a 1,000-foot view of what it is that we're talking about here when we talk about these conversations? And you mentioned how he's bringing in philosophical quotes and stuff. Can you give us that sort of intro, 1,000-foot view?
Yeah, absolutely. And you know, when he started it, he had, you know, major classroom management issues, and it originally started as a way to just kind of calm the kids down a little bit. And so he posted a philosophical quote on the board. Okay. That's the first part of the protocol. And then he has the kids analyze the quote and put it in their own words. What is this person saying here? Okay, so I'll just give an example. Like we use an Einstein quote I use a lot that it leads to a good conversation. Never do anything against conscience, even if the state demands it. Okay, so this idea of obedience, right? Do you obey your gut, or do you obey the government? Which is very appropriate today, obviously. So that's the first part of the protocol. Get the quote up, get the kids writing about it, thinking about it. And then, just when they start believing in the quote, turn it on them and say, okay, what's a counterclaim? what is an equally valid picture of the world that you can articulate that is just as true as the one you just believed in? So then the kids are, this is critical thinking right here. They're holding two competing ideas in their head, and now they're trying to figure out as a group which one is more reasonable. And that there is, that's the soil of the conversation right there. And then to kind of wrap up the conversation, you ask an essential question that takes the conversation, puts it in a box, and then you can lead it either into your curriculum, or if you just want to go strict SEL, you can just end it there. But in the example I gave you, the essential question of the quote, never do anything against conscience, even if the state demands it, you would end that conversation by asking the question, should you ever disobey authority? You leave them with that. And then, you know, again, they can write about it. They can journal about it. I use that to then teach the letter from a Birmingham jail by Dr. Martin Luther King Jr. And they have this conversation in their, you know, that led up to the primary source. And now they're engaging in the primary source in a really cool way because they were invested in the conversation beforehand. Does that make sense? That's the nuts and bolts right there.
Yeah, that makes a lot of sense. And I love that because you're getting there. You are giving them the opportunity and getting their minds thinking differently.
Yes.
And opened up differently before they start consuming the additional content, right? So they're getting the skills of critical thinking, of argument, of, you know, seeing it from the other side, all of those things and communication that goes into that. But then you're also really, you're opening their mind up to receive the, you know, the, whatever the other content is that you're going to now bring to them with a different mindset, right? And so I really love that because you really open up then to accept that differently, to analyze it differently, to think through it differently, potentially from both sides on their own because they're thinking like that now.
Yes,
like, how do I look at both angles and stuff? I love that. That's really cool. So that's over at – so that's teachdifferent.com, right? And I know you've got something that you want to make sure that everyone can get for free, right? And can you tell us what that is and how our listeners can grab that from you?
Yeah. Anyone listening, if you email me, dan@teachdifferent.com, not teachdifferently, but just teachdifferent.com, I could get you signed up for a weekly conversation. We send it every Tuesday morning at 7:30 a.m., and it gives you a quote. It gives you a sample claim, a counterclaim, a sample essential question, and it just puts it in a box for you. And then you can kind of think, hey, could I use this as SEL discussion? Or, hey, I could use this with content in an English class or whatever.
Very cool. All right. So just dan@teachdifferent.com to make sure that you shoot Dan an email and tell him that you want on that list. You want the weekly conversations. I love that, man. That's really, really cool. I'm super excited to dive into, and everyone knows this is my favorite question. And this is when we talk about failure and have you share a story. But I mean, I think you said 28 years now in the profession,
yeah,
correct?
Yeah.
Okay. So lots of opportunities there for a lot of these stories. So I'm interested to see where you pull from here, but can you share a story with us about a time you've had a failure that you've had to overcome? Kind of take us there with you. What happened? How did you overcome it? And then what'd you pull away from that experience?
Yeah, I love that. It's a great question. Actually, this will be 29 years ago because this was during my student teaching. And, you know, I had no idea what I was doing. Obviously, I was a month into it. And there was this kid in class. His name was Vinny. And throughout the class, it was a sociology class I was student teaching in. And throughout the class, he was constantly disrupting class, you know, ribbing me a little bit, ribbing the other students, kind of a little bit of a bully type, I would say. Not too extreme, but a little bit. And he'd never do anything that was enough to get him kicked out, if that makes sense. But he would bother everyone. He knew, you know, that I had no teaching experience and I couldn't control a room. So at the end of that experience, I sent a feedback sheet to the students. How did I do? What could I have improved on or whatever? I swear to you, half of the students said, you should have done something with Vinny immediately. And you didn't. And it was one of those moments where I had failed them for a good 2 months in student teaching, not ridding that class of a disruptive student. By ridding, I mean I should have connected with him and done something about it. And I call it a failure just because I feel like other students' learning suffered unnecessarily because of my inability to deal with one relationship in the room. And so from that, you know, I just learned I've got to learn how to manage human relationships before I learn how to teach.
You know, it's interesting, Dan. I think so many of us can reflect back on a moment similar to that, whether it be as large or even, you know, smaller, that we can say, hey, I handled something poorly in relationship to student behavior and others suffered and I need to be better in this area. And yeah. I think that's so relatable for all of our listeners as we continue to reflect on our careers, is whether you've been in the classroom for 6 months, 20 years, or you know, 30 years, anything in between, we all have these moments where we are able to learn and grow from. And I love that emphasis on, you know, reflecting on a failure, that I can only imagine when that failure happened, it became a massive success because it was a great teachable moment for yourself. So
yeah,
I really think those are powerful pieces of our reflection.
Yeah, and you also, Ray, with it, it's important, and this is another lesson on top of a lesson, you have to learn how to forgive yourself. Mm. And you know, for doing things, because if you don't learn to forgive yourself for the mistakes you make, it's hard to get motivated for the next day.
Yeah. No, absolutely. Absolutely it is. And we need to not carry that weight. That's really important.
Yep, really important.
So, Dan, when it comes to all the work you're doing, and I really I love hearing your passion and like the story behind the work you're doing, what's really keeping you excited about education right now and really fueling your fire?
This is going to sound weird because I really thought about this question a lot before this. In a weird way, this pandemic is giving us an opportunity as educators to reset our priorities on what's really important in education. I think for a long time, at least in my career, because I've seen a lot of things over almost 30 years, I feel like we were becoming very, very, you know, a little bit too obsessed with science and data and trying to measure everything and trying to put everything on charts and identify whether kids are learning or not learning, which is all important. I'm not saying that stuff is not important. It is. But I feel like part of the human aspect to this job had been moving away. And because of this pandemic, I think that there is now much more of a focus on students' well-being on equal par with their learning academically, so to speak. And I think that's a good thing. I think that in August, we're going to be walking into the classroom seeing our students more as human beings than we ever have because of what we've gone through.
No, it's so powerful too. I guess that leads really well into question five, which is about advice, right? I mean, like, how do we really enact change? What is one piece of advice that you want to leave with educators that hopefully works towards, you know, this larger mission?
I just think it's kind of what I learned from Vinny's story. It's start and end with human relationships. You know, find a kid. This kind of gets into like, what is a good routine? Find a kid every day that you want to connect with, get to know them a little bit, humanize them. And I think when you do that, you set yourself up for success in a very natural kind of way. So I think that that is something we can learn, the importance of relationships. But then, you know, you don't teach classes, you teach individuals. And so treating it kind of as a one-to-one challenge on a daily basis, I think makes it easier to tolerate the complexity of the work. Did I answer the question, Ray? I felt like I got off that. Okay.
Absolutely. I mean, the whole point of that question is to get people thinking, and holy cow, I think that will give us a lot to think on. Great piece of advice.
Yeah, absolutely, Dan. I love that piece of advice. Let's keep it going, man. I'm going to throw the next six questions at you. Your goal is to answer each one in 15 seconds or less. Are you ready?
Mm-hmm.
All right. What is one ed tech tool you cannot live without?
Google Forms. We use them at Teach Different. I use them in my classroom, my regular classroom. They are a great way to get student input.
What is a book you're reading right now?
Philosophy Gym by Stephen Law. It has little philosophy thought experiments. It just makes your head spin in a good way.
Who do you need to follow on Twitter or Instagram today?
Twitter, I have to give a shout out to Mary Ellen Daniels, who is the lead teacher mentor and instructional specialist for the Illinois Civics Hub. I have
yes.
She is awesome. I oh my God. With her. Do you know her, Ray?
Yes, and everyone talks about her. That's so funny. Yes, everybody loves her work.
Yeah, she's incredible. I've known her for at least 15 years, and I've done a lot of projects with her, and I've actually presented Teach Different with her in the Chicagoland area, so she's awesome. And then also Paul Solares, author of Learn Like a Pirate. He's just a great guy in Arlington Heights, which is near me, and just wonderful guy, just recently retired.
What is a good YouTube channel, website, or podcast educators should check out?
You know, I like the Teach Thought podcast. It's wegrowteachers.com. Drew Perkins is the facilitator on that podcast. It's really good. It gets into a lot of deep thinking about professional development and questioning and inquiry, the stuff that I really love and connect with.
Give us a daily, weekly, or monthly routine every teacher should get into.
Yeah, I kind of already gave this one, but I'll give it again. Connect with one student every day. Just go a little bit farther with one student. It could be, what did you do over the weekend? Or what excites you? Or what's stressing you out right now? Something. Those little seeds is what allow you to be successful as a teacher.
And what is the best piece of advice you've ever received?
One of the teachers I worked with at the beginning of my career said that, and it's always stuck with me, your great lessons might not be as good as you thought, and your bad lessons certainly are nowhere near as bad as you think.
Hmm.
And so it's a marathon, not a sprint. That's what teaching is. So develop kind of a, if this makes sense, like a almost like a stoic, even-handed approach every day so you can suffer the ups and downs and be successful.
Yeah.
I love
so
that.
So good. Yes. You know, Dan, I want to make sure that everyone can connect with you following this podcast and you go follow you on Twitter and Instagram and check out your website. Can you give us some details on where they can head to further connect with your content?
Yeah, I mean, you can go to teachdifferent.com, as you mentioned. We have a blog there. We're also starting a podcast as well. So love to check that out. Our podcast, if I could just talk about that real quick. We're calling it the Conversation Podcast, where we get 2 to 3 people on a call, and then we break down a quotation, and we model the 3-step protocol. That's the podcast. And so that way they can then take it into their classroom. And we're always looking for guests, so I'd love to have you guys too. And then Twitter, DM Fouts is my Twitter handle, and then I Teach Different is the Twitter handle for Teach Different.
I love it. And, you know, you can find all the links and all the resources and everything we mentioned in this episode over at teachbetter.com, as well as those really important links for connecting with Dan and keeping this conversation going. So head over to teachbetter.com for all of that. Be sure to hit subscribe so you don't miss any upcoming episodes. And if you can give us a rating and a review, we'd really appreciate that as well. Let's keep taking this one step further. Think of just three of your colleagues who need to hear these amazing stories and connect with these amazing educators and just share this podcast with them. Dan, man, really appreciate you coming on. Just love your story. Love what you're doing. Really appreciate the work that you and your brother are doing and what you're trying to do and how you're trying to help more and more educators be better and better for their students. And just really appreciate you taking some time and hanging out with us tonight, man. Thank you.
Yeah, thank you. You guys are doing great work, too. You know, I've been looking at your website a lot, bringing teachers together, offering these resources in your membership. I think it's great, and it's so needed.
I appreciate that a whole lot. And until next time, let's get out there and let's teach better.